Hi, it's good to see everybody. I'm sorry to have kept you waiting. I know that last year I said something about how this, last year's my first time up here for UN General Assembly Week, and I said it felt like diplomatic speed dating. This year, one of my colleagues noted that every profession needs a trade fair, and this is the diplomatic trade fair equivalent. Let me just put a couple things in, try to put some things in context here. When the Secretary has been working on the Middle East issues up here, she's been concentrating in large part, not exclusively, but in large part on comprehensive peace, the President's commitment to get to comprehensive peace. Obviously, there have been discussions with the Israelis. She saw Prime Minister Barak. She'll see President Abbas tonight about the negotiating track. But there's also been discussions on the need to support the institution building, capacity building, bottom-up approach of Palestinian Prime Minister Salam Fayyad. For example, she had breakfast with various Arab ministers and Salam Fayyad on Monday, where we talked about progress made toward the state-building exercise from the ground up, where Prime Minister Fayyad was able to highlight for Secretary Clinton and for the assembled Arab ministers some of the accomplishments that they've done on that essential part of getting to a Palestinian state. She also, of course, met with the Libyan Foreign Minister, Moussa Koussa, and among other topics there, she talked about the upcoming Arab Summit. There's an extraordinary Arab Summit on October 9th, and we believe it's important for the Arab League, for the Arab leaders, to continue to support the negotiating process as they have so far and within the spirit of the Arab Peace Initiative. Of course, part of our efforts on peace is aimed at a comprehensive peace, not simply the two-state solution. So she met today with the Lebanese President, Michel Sliman. She reaffirmed U.S. support for Lebanon and its state institutions, Lebanon's unity, Lebanon's stability, as well as for the Special Tribunal for Lebanon. But she also assured President Sliman that we are committed to coming up with a peace that will include peace between Lebanon and Syria that's to the benefit of both peoples. On Monday, Lebanon and Israel. I was already ahead, thinking ahead to the fact that on Monday she'll be meeting with the Syrian foreign minister, again, with the purpose of reaffirming our commitment to finding a comprehensive peace in the Middle East that will include peace between Syria and Israel. There have been, of course, a number of consultations at other levels as well, both bilateral and multilateral. We've had various multilateral groupings, such as the Friends of Yemen, that took place today to reaffirm international support for Yemen. There was a ad hoc liaison committee, which is a donor coordination committee, meeting to help coordinate aid to the Palestinian Authority. There have been a number of meetings that we've had at a number of levels, not only at the Secretary of State, on a pretty heavy Middle East, North Africa agenda. But with that, let's take some questions.
What's the status of getting the Israelis to extend the moratorium, or at least getting the Palestinians not to walk out on something?
Yeah, there's a pretty intense set of negotiations going on right now with the Israelis and Palestinians. As you know, Secretary Clinton will be meeting with President Abbas later tonight. And I'm sorry, I'm just not able to get into the details of how these discussions are. We know the time is short. This is an important issue, but I'm just not able to share much right now.
Well, is it fair to say that that's going to be the main topic of conversation?
You heard the President's statement at the United Nations that we believe that the settlement moratorium should be extended. We also believe that the parties need to stay in the negotiations and see the negotiations through to their conclusions. Yes, these will be among the topics discussed tonight with President Abbas, I'm sure.
In the meeting with Soleiman, did you discuss the idea that the Saudis, this new alliance between Saudi Arabia and Syria, and the idea that the Saudis are putting pressure on the Lebanese to kind of, absolve Syria of any involvement in the Hariri murder, and also just the fact that the Saudis are allowing the Syrians to get a hold once again in Lebanon?
Well, I'm the Special Tribunal for Lebanon. You know, I mentioned that in passing when I talked about this meeting, but let me just make it clear that the United States supports the Special Tribunal for Lebanon, along with a number of countries that support the Special Tribunal for Lebanon, which was created at the request of the Lebanese government. The Special Tribunal for Lebanon should not be politicized. We do not know what the Special Tribunal for Lebanon is investigating. We do not know when it will come up with any sorts of announcements. That's business of the Special Tribunal for Lebanon. It's a professional tribunal that has the support of two recent cabinets in Lebanon, the current cabinet, the previous cabinet, as well as the international body. We're not part of its work.
I understand about the tribunal, but what about the idea that the Saudis are giving Syria more of a hand, once again, in Lebanon, in an effort to kind of bring Syria along, you know, to pull it away from Iran, that basically Lebanon is the price?
Yeah, you can ask the Saudis for their views on Lebanon, but certainly in our conversations with Saudi Arabia and others in the region, we emphasize the point that the Lebanese need to be in charge of Lebanon. Lebanon's sovereignty, Lebanon's independence need to be respected, and we believe that Saudi Arabia understands the need to be creating the right regional context in which the Lebanese themselves can make decisions for Lebanon.
Do you really think they're doing that, though?
Yeah, we're in consultation with the Saudis as well as others about developments in Lebanon, and there has been a rise in tension over the past few weeks in Lebanon, without question. And we think it's in the interest of all of the many friends of Lebanon in the region and internationally to do what they can do to help reduce the tensions, to help create an atmosphere for the Lebanese to be able to make decisions on behalf of Lebanon.
Are you worried that the tribunal could just be defunded? I mean, the Saudis and the Lebanese governments, I think, pay for more than 50% of it. Hezbollah is putting so much pressure on Syria. I mean, I don't know how long the funding continues, but I've already seen Hezbollah come in, like, officials say, you know, we shouldn't be funding this thing for another year.
Well, right now, you're right. The Lebanese, I think it's about 50% of the funding. But if you go back and look at the original documents that were written, there was a number of means that the international community can use to raise funds for the tribunal. And we're convinced that for any society, it's important not to have impunity for murder. That the tribunal is not a political body. The tribunal is about justice and truth. And I think that's why the Lebanese supported it. When they asked the international community to help create it, the need for justice and truth, and we believe that there's still support for that.
On Syria, I mean, there seems like there's a lot of activity going now. Mitchell was there. I think Ahmadinejad was supposed to go to Algeria or something, and at the last minute went to Damascus instead. And there was, you know, talk in the Israeli press that Mitchell was carrying some message to Assad from Netanyahu. Can you give us any more sense that there's more going on here than just a simple meeting on Monday?
Well, I mean, you mentioned Ahmadinejad's visit. It is interesting that every time you have a U.S. official who goes to Damascus, you seem to have an Iranian official who feels obliged to go afterwards, which I think is interesting. But we want to get to a comprehensive peace. The comprehensive peace has to include the Syria-Israel track. It's absolutely essential that Syria be part of this process. And so we are talking to the Israelis and the Syrians about how best to get a credible peace process going between those two countries. So it's natural that Senator Mitchell went there. It's consistent with our policy. And Secretary Clinton will be seeing Foreign Minister Moala on Monday in that spirit. Because we have a lot of differences with Syria. Those differences aren't going to disappear overnight. But we also recognize that it is certainly in our interest to do what we can to engage the Syrians and Israelis in a peace process that can lead to a comprehensive peace.
Has the Secretary conveyed to the Lebanese President that the U.S. will resume providing Lebanon with military arms or not?
We're in consultation with consultation with Congress. We ourselves have reviewed what we have done over the past 5 years in terms of our assistance to Lebanon. But the Secretary of State assured the President that we remain committed to supporting Lebanon's state institutions.
Can I ask about the Syria meeting? This is coming after Senator Mitchell went to the region. Of course, Fred Hawk has been going also. So are you seeing progress in terms of is the Syria track still on the move forward? And did this come up also in the Secretary's meeting with Ehud Barak? I mean, what is the Israeli position on this?
The fact that the Secretary is seeing Foreign Minister Mualim on Monday, I think, speaks for itself in terms of our commitment and our hope that now is the right time to move forward in trying to restart the Syria-Israel track.
And just to follow up on that, you say that the time is opportune. Is this something that also is being discussed with the Palestinians and how the Palestinians feel about this?
Our view is that these tracks can reinforce each other. We can get momentum going on all the tracks if it becomes mutually reinforcing. And the Palestinians have told us that they would be very supportive of having a Syria track as well. This idea that you had back in the 90s of one track competing with the other no longer seems to prevail. That everyone recognizes the fact that going forward together is actually has positive benefits for the various tracks.
And I just want to ask you about the steps that the U.S. would like to see Arab countries take towards Israel, trying to explain what normalization would mean. Are you expecting something out of the Arab League meeting?
Well, we would hope that the Arab summit on October 9th would show that the Arabs remain committed to the Arab Peace Initiative and show that the Arabs continue to support President Abbas and the PLO in the negotiating track. It was essential in our view that Arab support of President Abbas was essential to starting the direct talks that we have now. We would hope that would continue. We also hope that the Arabs would continue and expand what's essential support to the Palestinian Authority, because the institution building pillar of Middle East peace is absolutely essential. You need to have institutions that are credible, that function that the Palestinian state will have upon its creation. So part of what we hope the Arabs will do is continue and expand their financial support for the Palestinian Authority. It's one of the reasons why Secretary Clinton wanted to go to this meeting between Prime Minister Fayyad and the Arab ministers. The President's words and the General Assembly, I think, were pretty clear, is that we also would hope that the Arabs, in the spirit of the Arab Peace Initiative, that's their own initiative, would find ways to signal what are the benefits to Israel of the type of comprehensive peace envisioned in that document.
Regarding the moratorium, an Israeli official has said today that Israel is ready for a compromise, and PJ has said yesterday that you've put on the table some ideas regarding this issue. Can you elaborate on that?
As I said earlier, these discussions are pretty intense right now, and I really can't go into much detail. But our position is that the settlement moratorium needs to be extended.
Like, what kind of compromise do you think you're able to do?
What I would say is that if the Palestinians and the Israelis worked out something between them that works for the two of them, of course we would support it. Our position as Americans is the settlement moratorium should be extended, and the talks should continue. We don't like the idea of seeing either side try to walk out of the talks when negotiations should lead to the solution that works for all.
Can I ask you about on the same issue? I understand you don't want to get into specifics, but could you say how confident you are that some agreement will be able to be reached before the expiration on Sunday, on or before?
All I can say is that the reason why I was late is because we're having some internal meetings. We're having a lot of discussions with the Israelis, with the Palestinians inside, about how best to proceed. We're very aware of this deadline, but we're also committed to keep to the negotiation track.
I'm not going to characterize how I feel about it at this point. The talks are pretty intense.
But do you see that the two sides want to come up with a compromise, or do you see like an obstinance on both sides? Or are you, when she asks if you're optimistic, it's not like if you're happy about what's happened, where things are. Do you sense a kind of decision on both sides to try and find a compromise?
What I sense is that the Israeli and Palestinian delegations are looking for ways to make sure the talks continue beyond Sunday. That's how I feel based on the meetings we've had here. And I also get the sense from the meetings that I have had bilaterally with various Arab as well as international officials that the region and the international community is also looking to find ways to make sure that the talks continue.
When you say pretty intense, you mean there's a shouting and yelling and pounding on tables and something else?
I'm just going to leave it it's pretty intense.
Would you expect the secretary to continue these intense involvement in the weekend leading up to Sunday? I mean, I realize the Sabbath and stuff is with difficulties, but how are we going to keep the pressure on right up to the moratorium?
The secretary certainly, I mean, that's why I was late, because the secretary is constantly talking to us about what should and could we be doing in order to promote our policy that the settlement moratorium be extended and that the talks continue.
So you're you're clearly putting pressure on Israel to extend the moratorium. You just said it without saying those words. I mean, keep saying we believe that the moratorium should be suspended. So you're urging.
Yes, we are urging Israel to extend the moratorium. Yes. And we also are making clear to the Palestinians that we do not believe that it is in their interest to walk out of the talks, that we do not believe that it helps them achieve their national goals if they would walk out of the talks. But at this point, we are urging both sides to create the atmosphere that is most conducive to a successful conclusion for negotiations, and for both sides to take the negotiation process seriously.
We have time for about one or two more questions.
Just one quick follow-up. Okay, I just wanted to ask quickly, the Secretary in her meetings here over the last week, has she been asking Arab ministers to support President Abbas if he does decide to go ahead with the moratorium to extend it? Because part of it, like you rightly said, the talks were started because the Arabs supported Abbas, so he has that pressure also.
We have talked to the, the Arab ministers to express appreciation for the support that they have given President Abbas, and basically to urge that support continue. But it's like pushing an open door. When we talk to the Arab ministers who are here, the Arab leaders who are here, it's clear that they do support a process, that they have expressed appreciation to President Obama for his leadership on this issue. I saw a number of Arab officials yesterday after President Obama's speech at the General Assembly, and they all expressed appreciation for the vision that he outlined. So when I say that we're urging them to continue the support for President Abbas in the negotiations, it really is like pushing an open door.
Last
question.
Amr Moussa this morning stated that he was not happy by the pressure you're putting on the Americans on being on the negotiation on the Palestinian. Do you have any
As we said before, we want to see a two-state solution that's an anchor for comprehensive peace. The best way to get to a two-state solution is through negotiations. The Palestinians and the Israelis have started a serious process. It is a process that is not going to be without difficulties. The gaps on some issues are quite wide, but it is nevertheless a promising way for the Palestinians to achieve their goal of statehood, for the Palestinians to have a state that they can call their own.
And I think that's consistent with what the Arab League itself has endorsed through the Arab Peace Initiative, and I think it's also consistent with what Arab leaders across the region have said should be the goal.
And you think it's just, and you think it's counterproductive, it sounds like you're saying that it's counterproductive for every time Abbas sees something that he doesn't like to walk out of the talks.
We don't think either side should be using the threat to walk out to interrupt the process that has the promise of bringing Israel security and bringing the Palestinians a state.
We gotta go.
I'll take that.
Thank you.
Thank you.